In this section, we're going to talk more about proof of work and other consensus mechanisms. So we're actually going to get into the alternative to proof of work. So Bitcoin, the other large blockchains like Ethereum, they use a proof of work mechanism in order to achieve consensus. But even back in 2012, there were alternatives that were launched, and specifically proof of stake. Proof of stake is the big alternative to proof of work. Many early blockchains use them, including Peercoin, NXT, and currently a lot of the more modern blockchains are now implementing those too, with EOS uses a variant called distributed proof of stake, Tezos uses another variant called liquid proof of stake. But the way all of those mechanisms or the proof of stake works in general is that your ability to create new blocks on the network is related to the amount of tokens or coins that you have on the network. So it's your stake in the system that gives you the ability to forge what is called forge new blocks. So in the early versions, it was actually, you still needed to do a bit of hashing, so you still needed to run through that cryptographic hash function. However, the target number that you needed to get below was you had a higher target if you owned more coins. So for every participant on the network, if you had, say, 1 million coins, your target would be pretty high, so it'd be very easy for you to forge a new block. And vice versa, if you only had like one coin, your target would be very low, so it'd be almost impossible for you to create a new block. And that's the big alternative to proof of work. It actually uses a far less electricity and special processors and special chips. So in the Bitcoin network and in Ethereum, generally they use either what's called ASICs or they use graphic chips. They'll use a lot of GUIs. So not graphical processing, GPUs rather. So those are really important in proof of work blockchains. When proof of stake, it uses this alternative model. And also, when you get into private blockchains, it becomes a lot easier to come up with a different consensus model, that there are other alternatives to these two systems. We've been talking a lot about consensus, and consensus, as we've spoken about, is really just with regard to the history of the blockchain. So everyone needs to have the same history, and we all need to converge on a single state. So that's consensus on the history. However, there is an alternative consensus that is also going on, and that is we need consensus on the rules of the network. That is, with the protocol itself. What do we consider to be a valid block? What do we consider a valid transaction? You know, how? What kind of hash function do we use? What does the target need to be? All those rules are in the program that everyone is running. And obviously, those two consensuses are related, that you need to have consensus on the rules in order to have consensus on the history, right? We can't create any consistent history if everyone is not following the same rules. And vice versa, we can't really even apply the rules correctly unless we already have some pre-agreed upon history. So these two ideas are tightly intertwined. However, the earlier blockchains like Bitcoin and Ethereum don't really have a good mechanism to ensure that everyone is running the same rules, which in other words means everyone needs to run the same version of the software. So you may run into a situation where part of the network or part of the participants want to upgrade the software, and then some other faction does not want to upgrade. And that indeed did happen both in Bitcoin, that there's now Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash. It happened in Ethereum, that now there are two versions, Ethereum and Ethereum Classic. And in both of these instances, it was because there was some change that was rolled out where not everybody was on board with that change. In the case of Bitcoin, it was because there was a proposal to increase the block size, that is how many transactions can be in a single block. So a lot of participants in the network wanted to increase that from 1 megabyte to 8 megabytes. A lot of the other participants wanted to still stick to the same 1 megabyte limit. So the 8 megabyte version became Bitcoin Cash. In Ethereum, there was also a large hack that stole about $60 million worth of Ether. In order to fix this issue, or there was an opportunity to rather undo or roll back that transaction, the Ethereum Foundation released an update that undoes it. However, There was about 10% of the Ethereum community that did not want to implement such a change. So since they did not upgrade, their version of the blockchain became known as Ethereum Classic, and the general Ethereum that everyone is, that most of the network is on, is the one that did implement this change to roll back that transaction with the stolen funds. So we have these two versions out there. So all these consensus models don't really handle this issue of getting everyone to use the same version of the software. Some of the newer blockchains, like Tezos, which is one that launched just a few months ago, they do incorporate, Tezos does incorporate a governance model within the chain itself so that token holders can vote on whether or not to upgrade or not, whether or not to upgrade the software, and whatever the majority wants goes. So even those that are not really happy with the upgrade, but nevertheless, since they're part of this system, that's very similar to being part of a country where you vote for some candidate, even if your person you voted for didn't win, you don't necessarily go off and split off and make your own country. You just go along with whatever the majority chose. There is another third component to consensus that's going on in public blockchains, and that is this idea that the underlying tokens that run on these blockchains, Bitcoin or Ether in the case of Ethereum, that these coins have some value. And the reason is because it is the tokens that act as the incentive mechanism for everyone to maintain this blockchain history, to run the software. And without this incentive mechanism, nobody would do anything. So all these miners or the participants, they're getting paid out in small increments of these tokens or coins. So it's with the interplay of all these three components, of the consensus on these three components, that the tokens have value, which in turn allow us to reach consensus on the history and also on the protocol. All these things work together on a public blockchain. In a private setting, there usually isn't any tokens of value, so there's some other kind of incentive mechanisms or there's some other kind of structures in place that allow all the participants to all be on the same page in terms of the software and the history that they're maintaining. So overall, consensus there are many different consensus models, although all those models are generally focused on consensus of the history. And there are other blockchains that are now trying to work on how do we actually also incorporate governance and consensus on the protocol side itself.